to another edition of Vert Athlete. I'm David Gill, Performance Lab Director with Vert, and here today we are joined again by Dr. Kerry McDonald. He's the head of sports science and sports medicine with Volleyball Canada. Kerry, thanks for coming on, bud.
Thanks, David. Thanks for having me.
Of course. So we're going to jump right into this one. The topic today is weekly training load periodizations for both optimizing performance on game day and kind of mitigating injury risk. Obviously, this is going to be a bit different because what we're going to go through today are basically just kind of throwing the ball in your court. What would you do if you were in this situation going back to your college coaching days? Because so many programs have the most insane schedules right now. For one of our clients, I think, has seven matches in 8 days starting this Saturday. So first I'd like to kick it off. I know typically when you're coaching, you're very used to kind of a Friday, Saturday match day. Kind of run us through, you know, your strategy for prepping to, you know, be ready to go for match day.
Yeah, thanks for having me. And I'm not envious of those that have to try and plan for seven matches in 8 days. The truth of the matter is you can't periodize well and perform consistently over that much time. That's just far too much volume and with likely not enough lead-in time to prepare an athlete for that. So that's cruel as a coach and on the athletes, obviously. So in our context, in Canada, we play Friday night, Saturday nights primarily. So we would kind of, we're prepping for the weekend, and then usually Sundays were kind of the off day. So what we would do throughout the week, if I kind of build it out from Monday heading towards kind of Friday, is Mondays tended to be a light day for those that played a lot on the Friday, Saturday. So they kind of got an extended recovery period. So they got the Sundays off. Monday was kind of activation, but their loads would be fairly low on those days. However, we actually loaded our bench players. Those didn't play a lot. They loaded very heavily on a Monday, and that was a real heavy, that was a big day for them to catch up on reps that they didn't get in the Friday and Saturday, real technical focus and a lot of staff focus on trying to help those that weren't playing. As we moved into the Tuesday, that's when we would kind of build what we would have called like moderate volume kind of build up, and then we would peak at our highest volume on Wednesday. That's when we would play our primary kind of match type load. So usually the equivalent of about a 4-set match is what we would end up doing on a Wednesday. We would then cut that down on Thursday, usually max out at about a 3-set match type load, and usually kind of spread out with good rest in between on our Thursday. So intensity high, volume fairly low. And then we play on Friday, Saturday, and kind of watch and repeat. So that worked well for us. But the one thing I'll just maybe say is how we determined that was really through a lot of trial and error. We tried different things and we found things that didn't work. We found things that did work, and we were using data to help inform that, as well as kind of subjective feedback from the athletes.
Yeah. And I'm really glad you brought up the point with which bench players. I've had this discussion a lot with other teams, is they'll kind of set up this program, and sometimes your program is going to be dependent upon, well, you just had like 2 5-set matches, so let's take that in consideration. But again, the players who did not play, they're losing those reps. And so if you are training them the same as your starters, something's imbalanced there. Additionally, I also like to point out that you correct me if I'm wrong, but you essentially would look at part of it. You'd look at from the objective side is kind of average jump height. Sometimes things like average of top 10 jumps, how many days after their high load day have they peaked?
Yeah, we looked a lot at, we do the average high calculation that comes from the Vert app. We would look at that, and then we would also take, it was actually a median value of their top 10 jumps. We would track that value over time as well. And so we would be able to assess after whether that day that athlete was able to perform near, you know, how optimal was that, those jump heights. And then the last thing we did is we also did every Thursday, actually, we used a Vertec assessment. And that was more for the athletes to see that as well. And so we did a vertec on Thursdays. Thursdays was a light day anyways. We had a ton on those days. So we would do a vertec assessment every Thursday for everybody and track that throughout the course of the season as another tool. But for the most part, it was the average jump, average high jump count and our median of the top 10 value that we went off of from our performance metrics to assess how their jump performance was.
Awesome. So now we move away from that, which you have lots of data on, and we look at just the reality of, you know, let's say you have, instead of a Friday-Saturday match, you have a Saturday-Saturday doubleheader. How much of what you're getting, and this is happening a lot right now, because in certain conferences that did get to play in the fall, they got hit and they missed. So would you essentially follow this very similar periodization, or would you, I guess you'd keep them a little higher on Thursday? What would be kind of your just initial thoughts looking at that kind of a week?
Yeah, if we had a week where we had to do a Saturday doubleheader, I would likely keep probably something similar. I would probably have a light day Thursday and Friday. So we have really strong recovery and very little residual fatigue as we head into that Saturday day. So that off the top of my head, I think that's probably that would be my attempt one at trying to manage that situation and then assess if it works or not, but probably something like that. And then my guess is I would also start planning immediately that we're going to need probably a longer recovery window. After that as well, 24 hours, 48 hours, we may even need to go into, 72 hours on recovery, depending on the individual and how the individual handles that as well. So that's a tough one. Doubleheader are not a common place. I mean, we get it in club volleyball, but we don't see that too much at the collegiate level.
No, I know. And you and I have talked about that a lot with club volleyball is trying to figure out with some of the youth athletes how to kind of periodize that training, and it's like it's just tough to prepare them for six matches in 2 days when they go into a tournament. And I guess the one of the last things I'd like to broach, because this is something else that's happening a lot and we get a lot of outreach, is let's say you have 5 weeks leading up to your match, which is a pretty nice runway. You're fortunate to get that right now. You're going for 3 weeks and then boom, you're out for 10 days. And you come back and you have what, week, a little less than a week for your match. Programs want to know, all right, so do I pick up where I left off? What would be kind of the advice to make sure that I don't, again, ramp them up too quickly again, but also not have them prepped for match day?
Yeah, that's a good question. I think the thing to consider is what are you able to do over those 10 days? So if those end up being 10 days of pure isolation quarantining, I'm going to assume that, a lot of the athletes that are maybe isolating are just close contacts. They don't have coronavirus, so they're healthy. And if that's the case, ideally we're able to still load them in whatever isolated or quarantined environment that they're in. So we can continue to do band work for the arm. We continue to do some jump work, or squats and things like that for the knees. So ideally we can continue to load those joints in particular so that we can come back in at a relatively close to where we left off. So if we are able to maintain load, then that would be the case. Now, if we're in a situation where we aren't able to do that, or we know maybe that athletes aren't maybe adhering to what we prescribed for them to do while they're in their isolation environment, then certainly we need to come back in at a lower load. There's just no way around that. Otherwise, we're going to come back and we're going to break them before they even get to play their first game back. So we are going to need to come in at a lower load and start assessing how they respond to that and ideally build towards that first game. But it may be an unoptimal level of load that you're going into that first game with. And you're hopefully just able to play catch up following that first game.
Yeah, it's making for a rather interesting spring down here. That's for certain. Typically in spring, that's when you have a bit more of that experimentation, right? We work with a lot of clients to kind of figure out what is the best periodization. They'll do Saturday scrimmages and kind of play around it week to week. You're not typically doing a lot of this experimentation in the middle of a season with games that can matter. But yeah, it's they're stuck in their dorm or their apartment. hopefully they're not like a 6'8" and they can only jump 10 inches in there, but figure something out, get some isometrics, get some jumps in. But yeah, no, Kerr, I think that's very helpful. Again, this is a topic that is obviously just top of mind for every coach down here. I mean, it's a topic that's always relevant, but these added variables coming in, we have to adapt. And as we've been discussing, given there's no real precedent for this, it's about listening to the athletes. Obviously, they have to take on a lot more responsibility than they typically have in the past. And yeah, you know, obviously you and I, from our backgrounds, we tend to say err on the side of caution, if especially right now, given what they're going through. But it's, yeah, there's gonna be a little trial and error this spring, even though you're in the middle of matches. So,
yeah. I mean, the last thing I'll maybe just say is be grateful. I mean, that we do get to play. And that's something, let's try and see some positive lights in that. Up here in Canada, there's no collegiate volleyball happening right now. And I know our athletes that are professional playing in Europe are pretty happy that they do get to play over there as well. So, and our athletes that are playing in NCAA are pretty happy they're down there right now too. So,
yeah, undoubtedly. Great point. All right, sir. Well, thanks again. Stay safe, stay healthy. We'll talk again soon. Again, this has been Vert Athlete. If you have any questions, you can reach out to us at performance@myvert.com. If you have questions about just jump numbers and periodizations, those are things you can do with the system, or if you're an advanced client, we will do that with you or for you. Again, I'm David Gill, and everyone stay safe.